One, two, three, four.
Time girl, I need a little more to light up my world. I want a woman, yeah, I want a woman like you. Same old, change the station to a new kind of cool kind of conversation. I want a woman, yeah, I want a woman like you. Oh, give me that sunshine stuff, some of that summertime moonlight love. Looking so sweet with a bad attitude. Shake it up all night long. Make a southern man wanna put you in a song. The right kind of wrong I wanna fall into. I want a woman, yeah, I want a woman like you. Yes, I do. Something that I can't explain. Set me on fire when you call my name. Loosen my mind when you're shaking that thing. Make me wanna give you that ring. Give me that sunshine stuff. Some of that summertime moonlight love. Looking so sweet with a bad attitude. Shake it up all night long. Make a southern man wanna put you in a song. The right kind of wrong. I want a woman, yeah, I want a woman like you. My heart all up in chains. I ain't ever gonna be the same. Give me that sunshine stuff. Some of that summertime moonlight love. Looking so sweet with a bad attitude. Shake it up all night long. Make a southern man wanna put you in a song. The right kind of wrong I wanna fall into. Yeah, I want a woman like you. I want a woman, yeah, I want a woman like you. Yeah. Yes, I do.
So hey guys, thanks for that great performance. We got to hear two fantastic tracks from The Traveller.
Thanks.
Now the album's out now. How do you feel now that it's out and you're performing these songs live?
Well, I'm excited. I mean, I'm glad the record is out, and you know, to get the feedback from the fans, and so far all the reviews have been great. But a lot of the fans are saying they think it might be our best album yet, and so to me that's wonderful feedback. Obviously. The versions that we just did are extremely stripped down versions of those two songs. But it's been a lot of fun playing them on stage. You know,
we're playing about, I don't know, half the album at any given show.
We worked up almost the whole record, and then just so far, I think we're doing about five songs in the set, and we'll probably work other ones in later on.
Yeah, and the fans, they really, you know, they're happy about that. They're not shouting to hear everything, all the old stuff.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, with an album list, you know, you guys have done many albums together, mm-hmm. and as you say, you know, sometimes you want to go out there and you almost want to play the whole record. Right. Other times, you know, like, I think this tour is going to be more of a greatest hits with a bit of a sprinkling. How did you decide on this one to actually have so much of the record? Do you just like what's on it so much?
Yeah, it's good. I mean, it's good for us because it
we
keeps
usually
it.
Do that. We usually include a lot of what we've just done.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and it keeps it fresh. And you know, it's the fresh, chill thing to do. And it's like really exciting, you know, for us to play some, the new material and to see how that affects the crowd and their response, like he said, has been like really great. Like we come out the gate, like the first four songs of the show are brand new songs. Yeah. And so, you know, the people are hearing, some of those people have never even heard those songs before, but they're like, they're cheering and they're jumping and, you know, they're clapping along. And by the end of each song, you can tell that you've won them over on that song.
Absolutely. Now on the, you know, and you know, I feel like this is almost like a little bit of a continuation, a little growth from that. It seems like they are in some way slightly connected. I don't know whether it's the production aspect on it on there, but were a lot of these tracks written at a similar time, or is this a whole new, you know, was this a whole new writing process in between the last record and this?
Well, the writing was a continuation of writing for Lay It On Down. There was actually, like, Woman Like You was actually written for Lay It On Down, but I'd felt that it did not fit that record, so I had to make the difficult decision to hold on to it and wait for the right album to come along, which was this one. And then, you know, the production is, I mean, you got me and Noah performing on it, and then you got the same other guys in the studio, Chris, Jim McGorman, Kevin McCormick, all the band guys are the same as the last record too. So, and Marshall,
and
co-producer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, there is that continuation, but this one kind of took on a little different vibe. This one rocks a little more than Lay It On Down.
Yeah.
Sure. And do you tend to write, do you guys like take a period just to write, or do you find that when you're on the road, because you guys, you know, the album's called The Traveler, you guys travel a heck of a lot, you're always on the road. Do you write on the road as well?
It's
hard to for us to write on the road.
It is. There's a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah. You know.
So we set aside time specifically for writing.
Fair enough.
We have written songs on the road, but it's unusual. Yeah.
And is the process always kind of the same for you guys? Like, you know, does it tend to be you just get together, you jam some stuff out, or, you know, Kenny, you bring it in tracks and it's like, this is like 70% of
it. We usually bring it in and then the band will take it and chew on it and form it and help them.
Yeah. Always starts with guitar all the time.
Yeah.
On the record, there's always killer tones. You're going to expect that from you guys all the way down the line. What gear are you using on this particular record? Anything new that the guys would love to hear about?
Well, I mean, it depends on...
Or old, of
what
course.
They heard about before, but... I mean, the most interesting, I mean, you know, I used a variety. I have my 61 Strat, my 59, and my 58 hardtails that I use all the time on every record, basically. And then I brought a number of my newer Fenders, like, you know, the Crossroads Strat, the custom shop creation that Todd Krause and I came up with, and Copper Boy, the Orange Sparkle Strat. And then some of my Signature Series and a new prototype for my new Signature Series is going to come out next year. Use that on some of the record. I used a brand new, at the time, 2018 American-made Gibson 335 on a couple songs. It sounded great. Used my Les Paul from the custom shop that my friend gave me a few years ago. But amps, for me, like the main thing really... The main recent contribution to my sound has been the amplifiers, because over the past 8 to 10 years, Alexander Dumble has been custom building me amps, and every one has a different circuit. Every one serves a different purpose. No two amps are the same. No two sound the same. And they have just elevated my creativity when it comes to playing guitar. It's just incredible. And so we lined up five or six of them. We had like the Slidewinder Bassman, the Ultraphonics Bandmaster. We had the Ultraphonics Rockphonics Pro Reverb. We had the Tweedledee Deluxe. We had the Little Tiger Champ that he did for me. And I think there was one more Bandmaster, the AC7. I can't remember what that circuit's called. But anyways, we had them all lined up. We had them in the hallway. We had big room mics and we had amps mic'd front and back. And we would just pick, like, you know, I would listen, isolate amps, and find the ones that were getting the right sound for each track and pick a blend of, like, two or three at a time.
That's killer. Now, we know that with Dumble, it's got that incredible reputation, you know, like, it's just an anomaly what's going on there. What's your take on why those Dumble amps are so killer?
Well, I mean, they are amazing. And in my opinion, his stuff lives up to the hype. I mean, I have that personal experience. And he's built these amps around my style of playing, which is probably the best thing. It's like getting a tailor-made suit versus grabbing one off the rack, you know. Having it tailored makes it perfectly fit your body, you know. So
he sits there in front of him and plays for hours.
I go to his house and he'll plug me into different amplifiers, and I sit for like at least a minimum of 4 hours, and we hang out and talk, and I just play, and he just sits there and listens, and I can tell he's trying to see what I'm trying to get the amplifier to do.
Okay.
He's listening to my style, my attack, my approach, and what I'm trying to get out of the amp, and then he goes and makes that happen so that I don't have to try to get the sound out of the amp. The amp just naturally gives it to me.
And, you know, it's interesting that, you know, you start playing in here, and then it's like you brought the Dumble sound to that little Fender with you. It's stored in your fingers now, you know. No, what about you in terms of gear, you know, what you're rocking?
I use some Relic Strats, and then my favorite one is my Signature Series. One of his first generation Signature Series with the racing stripes and the jumbo frets. That's my main one on the road. I love it.
Yeah.
I just kind of blend in. I try to blend it in with what he's doing, you know.
I'm sure.
He's a deluxe guy. He plays through a deluxe.
Yeah.
But what's interesting is that for both you guys, you've got that nice mix of sometimes you'll record with some older gear and some newer gear. Some gear just has like mojo. This room has got some mojo in it. Right. You know what I mean?
Yeah, right.
Like what is it about like a vibe? Like, what do you feel that's kind of like, this is the thing for me? This has got my sound. Is it a resonant thing, or is it just, I don't know, something you can't explain?
Yeah, it's kind of, you just pick it up and you play it, and it's either there or it's not. And it varies from, I mean, I have seen plenty of vintage 1950s, 1960s Stratocasters, Les Pauls, whatever you want to call it, you name it. And just because it was built in the 50s or 60s does not mean it's great. And some of them can have very high price tags. And to me, they sound and play like crap. But you can pick up one and go, oh my gosh, this is the holy grail right here. I can't live without this guitar. And then in contrast to that, I have many, many custom shop Strats that the people out of the custom shop have built me that stand up to any vintage guitar that I own or that I've played. I mean, in my opinion, they're making some of the best instruments today that they've ever made over you know, Fender and Gibson for that matter, you know.
We couldn't have you here playing in this great space without talking a little bit about Hendrix.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we're 50 years, about a month away, and you know, 50 years from Woodstock, the Woodstock performance. Yeah. Now, we know you've got a nice attachment there to that guitar that was played at Woodstock. Yeah. What's your feel on Hendrix? Why is it like 50 years on, he still has such an imprint on music, and yet he was only around for such a short period of time?
He was one of those anomalies, man. He was one of those stars that burned really like white hot, you know? And, you know, it's almost as if people like that can't be here that long, you know? Because I don't know if it's that, you know, the world can't handle it for that long or whatever, but he just revolutionized, you know, guitar playing. And, his music and his approach, I mean, he did things, if you consider what he did, what he accomplished in his career, but what he was doing with his records, his playing, the sounds he was trying to create with the limited amount of gear that he had available to him at the time. I mean, basically he had like a wah pedal, a Univibe, and an Octavia and a Fuzz Face, and that was like top of the line revolutionary stuff back then. And all the stuff that he was able to coax out of that instrument was just incredible. And the stuff that they were doing in the studio, running the tape backwards and all that, playing his guitar solo, knowing the tape was going to go back. I mean, just really forward-thinking stuff. So, I mean, I don't know why it was him and why he was that guy, but he absolutely was. And every guitar player that's come along since Hendrix has been touched by him and his music. So, you know, that's why he's constantly regarded as the greatest of all time.
I also thought it's quite important because you have played, well, you may have even played other guitars of his, Hendrix seemed to be the sort of guy that when it came to individual instruments, he wasn't really that important about which one it was. He would play it for one show or, you know, I mean, obviously there's a lot of stories of burning things and all that. We know he only did that a couple of times or whatever, but you know, there's not one guitar you necessarily associate that was like this very special one. But yet we see it differently, obviously, you know, even a player like yourself getting the chance to play it. Why do you think that he, you know, didn't have any real attachment to a specific instrument, especially when you can get so attached to your own ones?
Well, I think I can't speak for him, obviously, but I think that to him, obviously he didn't see himself as a collector. I don't know that how much people were guitar collectors back then. I don't think that they looked at those instruments as future collectible things that were going to appreciate and value the way that they have. I think they looked at them as like, this is a tool and I'm going to use it until it breaks, and then I'm going to get another one so I can continue my craft. You know, but I mean, it's a different situation today. Guitars are expensive. The old ones are more expensive than the new ones. And they're collectibles, so people treat them differently. But, you know, I think he was also, obviously he was part of that whole movement in the late 60s, so I think they were probably not trying to be too attached to material things anyways, you know. Yeah. But it was cool. Those things were, like, brand new. So, you know, you could go, you could throw away a 60s Strat and still go down the corner to the local music store and get a new 60s Strat, you know. It was like no big deal that they were brand new back then.
Makes a lot of sense. Now, ever since you burst onto the scene, there's been comparisons with players, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Hendrix, that we're talking about now. Obviously we're in this room, so I'm going to have to ask these questions about Hendrix, and I know you're a massive fan anyway, but over the years you've obviously done your own thing, you're your own player, you've got your own sound. That association that you had early on with these players, I'm sure you were very honoured at the time, and you probably still are, but does it sort of hold quite heavy on your recording process when people expect a certain type of sound from you?
Well,
it doesn't seem to bother him. I mean, I can sit from outside looking in. He just goes about it and plays it how he hears it. Mm. And I think he's gotten farther away from those comparisons just naturally over the years. And he embraces his idols and his influences, you know. But I think he's developed his own style of it, by, you know, far and wide.
Yeah, no, yeah. Without a doubt. I mean, guys who hear you know that, but you know that when people get a little snippet and then they go, oh, he sounds a bit like this guy, because people
have to compare. They can't let you just be yourself, or they have to put you in a little box, you know. And guitar players can be kind of bad about it, you know.
Especially
online, man. Yeah, those guys are ruthless. They sit around and all they do. I had to stop going on guitar forums because this one in particular, it seemed like in the general discussion column, it was like every title of every thread was negative. It's like, what's your least favorite Led Zeppelin song? What song do you wish the guitar player would have played differently? All they were doing was just sit around trashing everybody. So I was just like, oh man, I'm not going to listen to all this. So, you know, I go on to car forums now and talk to the gearheads on the car forums.
Well, that's it. You guys are out there really doing it. You're not just sitting in your bedroom. That's for sure. Now, one thing that you are doing when you're out there is playing a heck of a lot of shows. You're just doing some shows in the UK here. You know, we love when you're in town. The guys who are maybe not going to catch you on this tour, or they've already got the tickets by the time this is out, when will they get another chance to see you in the UK?
November. Well, yeah, we're coming back in November. We have 5 dates in the UK, and I don't know.
One is in London.
Yeah, at the Shepherd's Bush Empire. I don't, off the top of my head, I don't have all the dates memorized, but we're coming back in November. We're doing 5, and we're talking about already trying to plan a 2020 return as well.
Absolutely.
Are you bringing a Dumble?
You know what? So he built me the Pro Reverb amp head that he did for me. Specifically was built for me to bring over here. So he wired it up. He got a special transformer made, custom made, from Mercury Magnetics, so that we could switch it. It was his spec, but that way we could switch it for a 220 power to bring it over here. The problem is that I have to fly with it, right? And I mean, I could ship it, but like, I don't want to let it out of my sight. And I can't, it's too big to carry on. And I don't want to trust, you know, that the airline's not going to lose it. So we built it so I could bring it here, and I've been too scared to bring it. So eventually that amp, at least that one's going to make its way over.
We're going
to
get it here somehow.
That's it. So we'll look out for that post on social media when it is on the plane.
Here it is, it's right coming. Here. I'll have to buy it its own seat or something.
Yeah, that's it. Buy its own apartment, you know, so it can live here. Guys,
you can hang out here.
Absolute pleasure. Thanks very much.
Thank you.